Hi, I'm John Green. Welcome to Crash Course World History.
Hi, I'm John Green. Welcome to Crash Course World History.
Hi, my name is Rachel Washart, and I'll be the real host of today's episode of Crash Course World History. Today we're going to talk about a very important, yet not very well-known, historical figure, Hypatia of Alexandria. Miss Washart, if this person is so important, then why haven't I heard of them? Oh, me from the past, you still have a lot to learn. You probably haven't heard of her because she's been written out of history. Why is that? Because sexism. And, oh yeah, she was thought of as a heretic by the Christian church. We hear a lot about the great ancient Greek philosophers like Aristotle, Socrates, and Plato. Roman philosophers often expanded on their work, drawing inspiration from Greek texts and incorporating their new imperial influences. One of these philosophers was Plotinus, who established a school of thought called Neoplatonism. Hypatia of Alexandria established herself as a major philosopher in this field. Let's go to the thought bubble. Alexander the Great conquered many areas of Greece, Persia, and Egypt, establishing many cities in his wake. Most of these were named Alexandria, but the most influential was Alexandria, Egypt. It was home to a vast library and became a center of learning, setting the stage for Hypatia and her work. Hypatia was born in a time of decline for Alexandria. Caesar had burned then rebuilt the great library in 48 CE, but the library was destroyed completely in Hypatia's lifetime. Hypatia was born around 370 CE to Theon, the last professor at the University of Alexandria. Her upper-class background and unconventional father allowed her to receive an education unlike any other woman at the time. She became knowledgeable in astronomy, mathematics, and the works of great philosophers. She taught students and gave public lectures. The philosopher Damasius said of her, quote, "Donning the robe of a scholar, the lady made appearances around the center of the city, expounding in public to those willing to listen on Plato or Aristotle." Many men were interested in her, but Hypatia never married, and she remained celibate throughout her life, possibly in keeping with Pluto's suggestions about the abolition of the family unit. Thanks, Thought Bubble! Hypatia lived during a time of religious tension. Two major figures, Cyril and Orestes, were having a conflict over power. Cyril, the religious leader of the city, wanted the church to possess the most power and influence, while Orestes, the political leader of the city, wanted his government to keep his power. They clashed many times, including riots on the streets and a few assassination attempts. Hypatia became a casualty in this fight. She was a pagan, which already made her a target of the religious people of the city, and she publicly professed Neoplatonic beliefs, which went against some teachings of the church. A rumor spread that Hypatia was encouraging the rivalry between Orestes and Cyril. So, Peter the Lector gathered up a mob of angry citizens, and Hypatia was no more. Hypatia's death gives us an interesting talking point about various influences on the way we perceive history. Cyril, who may have been indirectly responsible for Hypatia's death, became a saint in the church for his work on abolishing paganism. Meanwhile, Hypatia's contributions are not very well known, partially because monks in the Middle Ages copied her out of history or portrayed her in a bad light, but also partly because of sexism. Many historians believe that some of the works attributed to her father are actually Hypatia's writings. Which reminds me, it's time for the open letter. Magic! An open letter to the American education system. But first, let's see what's in the secret compartment. Oh look, it's my old history textbook. Dear American education system, I hate to criticize, but come on. So many kids only learn the Eurocentric version of history.
For Europe, the prime meridian runs through us. We're in the middle of every map, and we get to be a continent even though we're not a continent.
I mean, Asia exists, people. Most people don't even know that there were Islamic empires, like the Abbasid Caliphate, at one point in history. Not to mention, our people are becoming worldwide embarrassments, since our beauty pageant contestants can't answer simple questions. But let's get real. Our history curriculum focuses on great men and their achievements. So we don't hear about people like Sybil Ludington, who rode twice as far as Paul Revere. But does she get a special poem? This focus on great men leaves out the common people, whose movements and decisions affect our lives just as much today. And this is the reason why most people have never heard of Hypatia of Alexandria. Best wishes, Rachel Washart. So in the end, what was Hypatia's impact and why is she important to remember? Firstly, she contributed vastly to the science fields, publishing books and speaking about mathematics and astronomy. She was a leading philosopher and teacher of her day, helping to solidify the teachings of Neoplatonism, which eventually greatly impacted the Christian beliefs about God and the Trinity. She was also recognized as an outstanding teacher, able to explain difficult and complex concepts with ease. Additionally, Hypatia's death has come to represent the destruction of learning and culture due to religious intolerance. Side note, this isn't terribly uncommon for religious tensions to lead to a shift in power, since almost every empire had some form of religious oppression. Unless you are, wait for it, the Mongols. But Hypatia is particularly important in the fact that she is a woman. The historian Slatekin once said of women at the time, quote, "All classes were occupied with the same type of work, mostly centered around the domestic needs of the family. Women cared for young children, nursed the sick, and prepared food." However, Hypatia did not fit this mold. She was educated, she was outspoken, and she was influential. She was the first woman to have ever held a teaching position at the University of Alexandria, and her death was linked to the decline of this institution and the city of Alexandria as a whole. Hypatia's legacy has even lasted beyond her time. She's become a role model for feminists, a martyr to pagans and atheists, and a character in fiction. Voltaire cited her in his arguments against the church. Charles Kingsley made her the subject of his romance novel. And the movie Agora was made about her efforts to protect the texts of the Library of Alexandria.
In the last days of the Roman Empire, at the fall of civilization, one woman, a legend, ahead of her time.
Why should this assembly accept the counsel of a woman?
Your God has not yet proved himself more merciful than his predecessor.
You don't question what you believe.
Michael Deacon, an author of a book about Hypatia, sums it up perfectly. Quote, "Almost alone, virtually the last academic, she stood for intellectual values, for rigorous mathematics, ascetic Neoplatonism, and the crucial role of the mind, and the voice of temperance and moderation in civic life. Hypatia's death led to the decline of Alexandria, but her life still serves as an inspiration to many today." Thanks for watching. I'll see you next week when we talk about Catholicism. Crash Course is produced, directed, and funded by me. Thank you and goodbye.
Don't forget to be awesome.